share the word of God responsibly, that we're being the 96th psalm, the great 15 in our hymnals. You share the musical response as well. First, we pray. Lord, out of your love for us, your desire to save us, you feed us with your word. In feeding upon this, may we draw closer to you. May our lives be shaped more like yours.
goes swimming, makes surfing, other kinds of stuff at the beach, right? And I have my goggles, so I go in the water. I've got all kinds of ideas. What if I told you that you guys could actually come with me to the beach? You can do that by coming here for vacation Bible school, or VBS is what they call it, because we are going to have a surf shack come to us June 20th through the 24th at 8:30 in the morning. So be sure you tell your friends, tell all your family members to come to surf shack so we can all go to the beach together. So I'm going to tell you a little more about what people will think of, but I need your help. I need your help too, because I'm putting two kids up here. I need to pretend every time I see them on water, you guys have to pretend like you're going swimming. Okay, so you need to do that on the practice. Water. There you go. All right, water. All right, you got it. All right, so we're going to have our vacation Bible school here, and we've got our good friend, Snappy, who will help me tell all kinds of his stories about Jesus and the water. There you go, you got it. So we're going to learn about some cool stories about this and a helpful Bible verse. And it says, remember that the Lord is great and awesome. And we're going to learn about all kinds of cool things that are great and awesome that God did with water. Not only did God create the water, but he did some really cool things with it. Like there's a story about floating something down a river, which is a large natural stream of but there's also a story about a baptism, which is when we sprinkle or dunk somebody in water. And there's a story about fishermen. You know, Jesus met some fishermen, and they had to put their nets in. What did they put their nets in?
Water.
Water. They put their nets in water to catch some fish. Who knew that there were all these cool stories about Jesus in water? Very cool. So be sure that you can tell all your friends, all your family members, tell your dog about Ritchie Bible School, so they can all come and have a surfing good time June 28th through 24th, 11:30, 8:30 to 11:30 in the morning. And be sure to tell them that it's all about water. Water! Alright, so I'll see you then, dudes, but before we go down to Children's Church, we're going to say a prayer. So I'm going to say it, you say it after me. Ready? Dear God, thank you for the water. And all the amazing things you do. Thanks for letting us come together and learn about you and worship you at church and at VBS. Amen. All right, so cowabunga, and I'll see you dudes then. Here, have fun at Children's Church. And you be sure to tell all the children in your life to come and have a serving good time. Cowabunga!
share the New Testament lesson in Paul's letter to the Galatians, chapter 1, verses 1 through 12. The opening of this letter. Let us hear the word of God. Paul, an apostle, not for men nor for man, but through Jesus Christ and God the Father who raised him from the dead, and all the brethren who are with me, to the churches of Galatia. Grace to you and peace, God the Father and our Lord Jesus Christ, who gave himself for our sins to deliver us from the present evil age, according to the will of our God and Father, to whom be the glory forever and ever. Amen. I am astonished that you are so quickly deserting him who called you in the grace of Christ and turning to a different gospel. Not that there is another gospel, but there are some who trouble you and want to pervert the gospel of Christ. But even if we or an angel from heaven should preach to you a gospel contrary to that which we preach to you, let him be accursed. Said before, so now I say again, if anyone is preaching to you a gospel contrary to that which you receive, let him be accursed. Am I now seeking the favor of men or of God? Or am I trying to please men? If I were still pleasing men, I would not be a servant of Christ. For I would have you know, brethren, that the gospel which was preached by me is not man's gospel. For I did not receive it from man, nor was I taught it, but it came through a revelation of Jesus Christ. This is the word of our Lord. When it's my practice as I prepare for Sunday worship to choose scripture several months out, and then as Sunday approaches, to assign prayers, litanies, and hymns in support of the scripture. It is helpful as I do this to go to various online resources, especially a worship site maintained by the United Methodist Church. This site for each passage of Scripture suggests various hymns from our hymn books. I share with you this morning, there were a few hymns suggested for this passage from Galatians. I'm guessing this is because it is not an easy task for a writer to compose a hymn addressing the anger, the conflict at hand in this correspondence between Paul and the churches in Galatia. I mean, how is one to write a hymn addressing words such as, I'm astonished that you are so quickly deserting him who called you in the grace and turning the grace of Christ and turning to a different gospel? Or how does anyone to write a hymn speaking to words such as, but even if we or an angel from heaven should preach to you a gospel contrary to that which we preach to you, let it be accursed? How are we to write hymns carrying this level of anger? Am I now seeking the favor of men or of God? Or am I still trying to please men? If I were still pleasing men, I should not be a servant Christ. Do we hear this? Paul is angry. So angry that as he begins this letter, he offers not one word of thanksgiving. Paul writes to the Philippians, the Corinthians, the Romans. He offers words of thanksgiving. I thank my God in all my remembrance of you, not to the Galatians. Not when he's this angry. So, if you're feeling some nudge to write a hymn or to corresponding to this scripture, there is great opportunity for you to do so. But we understand it's not that easy. Now, to speak of the blessing of family as we did last week, that's a topic inviting the writing of countless happy tunes. Family discord is before us now, even as scripture. Not a blessed thing to witness, not something inspiring in the writing of hymns. I was speaking with a Baptist pastor once about conflict within family, conflict within church. As we spoke, he said, in church, as in family, Galatians. Why engage them at all? I mean, judging from what Paul writes, these people are missing the mark by a long shot. We're not talking about some insignificant issue of doctrine. We are not talking about some technicality of faith. We're not talking about immersion versus sprinkling. We're not talking about receiving communion by common cup or by the individual cups. We have before us a crisis of faith. I am astonished that you are so quickly deserting him who called you in the grace of Christ and turning to a different gospel. Not that there is another gospel, but there are some who trouble you and want to pervert the gospel of Christ. Never easy to witness family discord. Perhaps you've had the experience as I have, walking into a home and knowing without anyone saying a word, this is not a family at peace. You can feel it, see it, the silence, the expressionless faces, the lack of eye contact, the sense that everyone wishes they were somewhere else. You need not have been present to have heard the ugly words, to have seen the faces drawn tight in anger, to have seen the pointing fingers, to know this is a family far from peace. We've experienced this with family. We may have experienced this with church. The memory is painful, the memory of wanting to be somewhere else. The Apostle Paul, his words to the churches of Galatia before us, can choose to be somewhere else. He can direct his energies to the churches in Philippi, churches with which he seems to be of one heart. He can work on his relationship with the churches in Corinth. True, this at times has been a difficult relationship with for him. There are those in the church in Corinth that are far from perfect. But there is reward for Paul in this relationship. There are those in the church in Corinth who are getting it. Or perhaps most importantly, Paul can set his sights on his planned trip to Rome. He hasn't been to Rome, this place from which he can make his way to Spain, thereby launching a new chapter and spreading the gospel of Jesus Christ. These options are before Paul as he seeks to share the gospel, a gospel according to him, perverted by those in Galatia. So why bother with these persons who have strayed from the path they're called to follow? Perhaps because Paul, as angry as he is, as profane as he can be, still remembers the Christ whom he serves. That is to say, Paul knows he serves a Lord who refuses to give up on his people. Paul knows he serves a Lord who does not stop at second chances. He gives third, fourth, fifth chances. Paul knows he serves a Lord who searches for lost sheep, who looks out his window for the return of wayward children, who refuses to give up on what he has made. So though he may not like to do so, Paul looks beyond himself. He looks to his Lord and seeks to bring those in the church at Corinth back to the right path. He reflects the will and nature of God, a God who does not easily dismiss his people, but works tirelessly to gather them within his saving embrace. So rather than direct his attention elsewhere, rather than wash his hands of these Galatians, he engages them, witnessing not to his will, but to the will of the God who called him. In doing this, could it be that Paul remembers the one baptism shared by all who follow Jesus Christ? I ask this because we know that the United Methodists have just shared in a season of debate our general conference having concluded this past Friday. In anticipation of this conference and the expected debate regarding human sexuality, many articles and essays were circulated within the church before this conference began regarding how the United Methodist Church may remain united even in a time of disagreement. One such article I read is titled, "Baptism is Thicker Than Water." In this article, with the unifying sacrament of baptism as governing image, the author writes, "The United Methodist Church does not rebaptize because baptism is not something we do for God, but is an acknowledgement of what God has done for us and continues to do in and through us. There are no take-backsies with baptism." Which means, he writes, quite figuratively and literally, we are stuck with each other. Whether we like it or not, baptism is thicker than water. We are brothers and sisters in Christ, regardless of our behaviors and or beliefs. Just as family has to figure out how to live together in the midst of all its differences, the church must do likewise. Self-righteously separating ourselves from those who disappoint us by their defective apprehension of truth doesn't solve the thing. We are still guilty by association. I can't reject my siblings, I can reject my siblings, but that doesn't make us any less related. And hiding from an inability to relate is not a solution, but an abdication of responsibility and plain evidence of immaturity. He continues. So we really have only one option as Christians. Figure out how to live together through our disagreements and provide a witness to the world that through God's power we commit to a better way to disagree than to resort to worldly solutions of violence, exile, hate, invective, insult, and separation. Instead of focusing our attention and energy on what we disagree about, the body of Christ needs to start in a different place at the fundamental unity of our baptism and the essential covenantal commitment to engage at the level of our common agreements and sacramental identity. Paul doesn't mention baptism here, yet in seeking to gather those of the church into the gospel of Christ, in seeking to create unity, reconciliation, Paul draws from the source in which we are all gathered. What baptism in the name of Jesus Christ. I hear, remember again, the Lutheran pastor Nadia Holzweg. She writes in her book, Accidental Saints. She writes, "It's my practice to welcome new people to the church by making sure they know that House for All Sinners and Saints will at some point let them in. That I will say or do something stupid and disappointing. And then I encourage them to decide before that happens if they will stick around after it happens. They leave by telling them, they will miss the way that God's grace comes in and fills in the cracks left behind by our brokenness. And that's too beautiful to miss." While serving a church in Richmond's West End, we at the church participated with many faith communities in a ministry called Caritas, communities around Richmond involved in the Shore Shelter. This meant that for 1 week each February, you provided food and shelter between 35 and 40 homeless persons. In addition to providing meals and places to sleep, we also wanted to provide a worship experience for these guests. While they were invited to our regular Sunday services and some attended, we planned an additional service of worship for these guests one evening during their stay. So we set a number of chairs in a circle in the altar area of the church, wanting this to be a relaxed, non-threatening service. Leading worship while I was seated, I guided us through time of prayer, scripture, and began my message. And I wanted it to be something of a conversational message, something relevant to it, something connecting with the lives of these homeless guests. So I shared a story or two, and then I began to make reference to a favorite movie or two of mine, hoping in some creative and informal way to share the gospel with these guests. So on and on this went for a little while. Then I see a hand go up. I continue with my message. The gentleman who has raised his hand begins to wave it back and forth. Thankfully, this rarely happens when I preach. But along with this raving hand, there also came a voice. The voice of the man waving his hand, "Excuse me, excuse me." Well, realizing I cannot proceed with this interruption, I stopped. I looked at the man, saying to him, "Yes, sir." "Excuse me," he says once more, "but are we still talking about Jesus Christ?" The Christian church, called to go into all the world, baptized in the name of Jesus Christ, has often found it more compelling for any number of reasons to talk about other things. The United Methodist Church, whose mission is to make disciples of Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world, it's found it easy at times to lift up many a cause the expense of the gospel of Jesus Christ. So as painful as it is for me to recall, and as indicted as I was, the prophetic question of the poor, tired, homeless gentleman from Ritchie, a question in line with this scripture of Galatians, it's a question resounding still in my ears, are we still talking about Jesus Christ? The question remains, I won't let it go, and I won't let it go, you know why? Because it's my hope. I meet this man again one day. We rush to him, boldly, unapologetically, say yes. Yes. We're talking about Jesus Christ. God to us with relentless and endless love. You call us into relationship with you. Our presence here this morning, all that you entrust to us, is evidence of your love and desire to make us your own. With these gifts, may your name be glorified, may you be blessed, may you be inspired to share the good news of Christ our Lord.
Pray for churches and Christians
throughout the world. Remind us of our common foundation in Christ. May we grow together in faith and in love until we attain that unity which is your will. Build us together in Christ. Send down your spirit so that we may know Jesus, bear witness to our life and unity in him. May we know the mind of Christ in order to speak God's wisdom everywhere. Strengthen us to work towards peace and reconciliation in church and society. Build us together in Christ. Pray for all churches experiencing change, growth, struggle, reconciliation, or conflict. Inspire and strengthen them in works of goodness and service. Build us together in Christ. Pray for those who have no home, no land, no food, no work, no medicine, no peace. May we recognize and serve Christ in the suffering and the need. Build us together in Christ. Thank you for all your gifts of creation. Teach us to share with others our time, our energy, our resources, and our love. Make us sensitive and responsive to the wounds in the human family of creation. May we be faithful to our calling and live a long life on earth. May we give our whole life to Christ. We belong to him, and in him are united all things, on earth and in heaven. So now we pray as he has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Remember the unity that we share in our baptism.